Hello everyone. In this lecture, we will learn about the concept of parthenogenesis, its types and significance. I am Dr. Lata, Assistant Professor, Department of Zoology, Maharani Science College for Women, Bengaluru. Now, when we look in nature, the most widely distributed mode of propagation in animal kingdom is the sexual reproduction. And this sexual reproduction ensures two things. One is reduction in the chromosome number, resulting in the formation of gametes, and fertilization of male and female gamete to form a zygote so that it can restore the number of chromosomes similar to that of parents. At the same time, people noticed certain other forms of reproduction also, wherein a scientist by name Locke and others, they observed that fertilization is not essential for the process of development, and in certain cases, under certain conditions, the unfertilized egg may be stimulated to develop without the aid of spermatozoon. Such cases of development are termed as parthenogenetic cases, and the phenomenon as parthenogenesis. Parthenos means virgin, genesis means origin. So the individuals who originate from a virgin without the participation of the sperm is what is called as parthenogenesis. And the individuals which reproduce by this process is called as parthenotes. Then people thought that this process of reproduction, wherein the development of egg takes place without the fertilization, is what is called as parthenogenesis. Later, a scientist by name Beatty in 1967, he observed that when the eggs develop like this by a process of parthenogenesis, somewhere at some stage the development was halted and they didn't mature as an adult individuals. So by looking into all such features, he put forth a different, a modified version of the parthenogenesis definition, wherein he said parthenogenesis is the development of a female gamete into an embryo without any genetic contribution from the male gamete, with or without the attainment of adulthood. Here he highlighted the parthenotes may give rise to an individual which can attain in adulthood or which may not attain in adulthood. So this phenomenon of parthenogenesis, it occurs in different groups of animals such as insects, crustaceans and rotifers. Now, parthenogenesis can be of two types. One is natural parthenogenesis and artificial one. Now, as the name suggests, natural parthenogenesis occurs in nature, whereas artificial parthenogenesis can be induced. It is an induced mode of reproduction using either certain physical means or chemical means, and that is classified under artificial parthenogenesis. Now let us learn these two one by one. First, we will take up natural parthenogenesis. Now in natural parthenogenesis, what happens? This process occurs regularly and constantly and naturally in their life cycles, and hence it is known as natural parthenogenesis or obligatory parthenogenesis. It's a compulsive mode of reproduction, which is seen in aphids, rotifers, insects, and even in a lizard, wherein the Lacerta saxicola americana is the species of lizard that reproduces exclusively by parthenogenesis. It occurs naturally in those species, and since it occurs by naturally, the reproduction occurs by parthenogenesis, what is the consequence? Can you guess? Parthenogenesis, we said that does not involve the participation of a sperm. So here they reproduce completely by parthenogenesis, exclusively by parthenogenesis. That means the whole population of this Lacerta lizard contains only females and you don't find any males in them. So the individuals, they may breed exclusively by parthenogenesis with no sexual generation, or they might exhibit an alternation of sexual and parthenogenetic generations. Now, based on this, the natural parthenogenesis can be of two types. One is complete, the other one is incomplete. In case of complete parthenogenesis, the males are completely absent and the population contains only females. Whereas in case of incomplete or cyclic or partial parthenogenesis, sexual generation alternates with parthenogenetic generation. Now, these are the aphids. The one which you see on your green pictures are of the aphids. Next comes the rotifers, and these are the crustaceans or the arachnids. Now, what is complete parthenogenesis? Certain insects, they have no sexual phase and no males. So, they depend exclusively on parthenogenesis for the self-reproduction. This type of parthenogenesis is known as complete parthenogenesis or obligatory parthenogenesis. Here, the females develop from the unfertilized diploid eggs. And here, you do not come across the possibility of genetic exchange of genetic material and recombination of genes as seen in aphids and rotifers. Whereas in case of incomplete or cyclic parthenogenesis, here the insects which exhibit this incomplete parthenogenesis, they show two generations, that is the sexual generation and the parthenogenetic generation, and both of which alternate to each other. So in such cases, what happens? The diploid eggs produce females and the unfertilized eggs produce males. So this type of parthenogenesis is known as partial or incomplete or cyclic parthenogenesis, and this is commonly seen in bees and wasps. Now, this complete or incomplete type of natural parthenogenesis can be of two types. They can either be of haploid or arhenotocus parthenogenesis, or diploid or teletocus parthenogenesis or teletoki. Now first let us look into haploid or arhenotocus parthenogenesis. So here what happens? The haploid eggs are not fertilized by the sperms and hence they develop into haploid individuals itself. In these cases, the haploid individuals are always males and the diploid individuals are always female. Okay, so such kind of parthenogenesis is seen in the insects, the arachnids and rotifers. And this schematic diagram gives you a clear idea as to what these haploid or arhenotocus parthenogenesis are. Say here you can observe the haploid egg, which is formed as a result of oogenesis, that develops into the embryo without fusing with the sperm. The developing embryo and the adult are also haploid, consisting of half the number of chromosomes as found in this species. The ovum or the egg is formed typically with one reduction division and putting out two polar bodies. Okay. So these haploid individuals that are formed are males, and the females on the other hand are diploid and develop from the fertilized egg in the normal manner. And hence this haploid parthenogenesis is not only the method of reproduction, but it is also a method of sex determination. The next one, and you find similar kind of this haploid parthenogenesis happening in insects, I mean bees and wasps and arachnids and rotifers. In whichever example you take, the basic, the baseline of this mode of reproduction is the same that we discussed, but it varies from one species to the other. Means to say, all haploid will develop into males, and all the diploid ones which gets fertilized by a sperm, that develop into a female. And similar examples you find in insect, arachnids and rotifers. Now coming to the second type, that is the diploid or parthenogenesis or teletoky. Here what happens, the young individuals, they develop from the unfertilized diploid eggs. The diploid number in the ovum is either retained by obliterating the reduction division or is secondarily restored by fusing with one of the polar bodies that cast off during the process of maturation. So based on this, this teletoky is of two types. One is ameiotic and meiotic. Now in ameiotic parthenogenesis, what happens? During this process of oogenesis, the first meiotic or reduction division does not occur, but the second meiotic division occurs as usual. So such eggs contain diploid number of chromosomes and develop into new individuals without the fertilization. This type of parthenogenesis is what is called as apomictic or ameiotic parthenogenesis, which is seen in isopods, mollusk and other species. Whereas when you look into meiotic parthenogenesis, here certain eggs develop by a usual process of oogenesis, but at certain stages diplosis or doubling of chromosome number takes place. Hence it results in the production of diploid eggs. So such diploid eggs, they develop into diploid individuals, and this phenomenon is known as meiotic parthenogenesis. Now when we say diplosis, how can this diplosis occur? At what stage the doubling of chromosomes takes place? This process of diplosis, it may occur by two methods. One is autofertilization or by restitution. Now when you look into auto-fertilization, what does the term say? Auto-fertilization, self-fertilization. The haploid ovum fertilizes with the polar body, and hence it is called as an auto-fertilization. Observe the diagram carefully. It is schematically very well represented. And here what happens? The oocyte divides meiotically up to the formation of a ooted or ovum and the secondary polocyte. But the ooted and the secondary polocyte, they unite together to form a diploid egg, and which develops into a new individual. And this kind of autofertilization is seen in many crustaceans and others. Whereas when you talk about restitution, in a primary oocyte, the karyokinesis forms a nucleus of the secondary oocyte and nucleus of the first polocyte. But the karyokinesis is not followed by cytokinesis. Then the chromosomes of both the daughter nuclei are arranged on the equator, and they undergo second meiotic division to form a diploid ooted and a diploid polocyte. Then this diploid ooted or the ovum, that develops into a parthenogenetic diploid individual. Now this type of diplosis is known as the restitution. Example, it occurs in insects of the order Hymenoptera and Lepidoptera. That's how the diploid number get restored in this process of restitution. So far we learned that natural parthenogenesis is divided. Parthenogenesis in general is of two types, natural and artificial. Natural parthenogenesis can be studied under two headings, complete and incomplete. Then this complete and incomplete parthenogenesis can be grouped into two, that is haploid or arenotoky and diploid the teletoky. And this diploid teletoky can be studied under, like during this diploid teletoky, that can be classified into ameiotic and meiotic. And this meiotic diploid parthenogenesis, you come across diplosis of chromosomes, and this diplosis can occur by two methods, either by autofertilization or restitution. Now this slide gives you an overall summary of different types that we have discussed so far. Now moving on, the next concept we will learn is artificial parthenogenesis. So here the name itself suggests artificial parthenogenesis. That means this is something which does not occur in nature, but we can induce these kind of process of parthenogenesis to occur. Okay, hence it is called as artificial parthenogenesis. Here the eggs develops into young individuals by fertilization. Sometimes it may develop parthenogenetically under certain conditions, and hence it is an artificial parthenogenesis, and this can be induced by agents like physical agents or chemical agents. At this juncture, I'll just give you an example, like how people discovered or observe this process of artificial parthenogenesis. Now, it was first observed by Brucier in 1847, when he observed that the unfertilized female silk moth laid eggs when it is kept in sunlight for sometime. So then he thought, how is this possible? Then he thought, maybe the warmth of the sunlight must have triggered this silk moth to lay eggs. Okay, but this moth was not fertilized, so it laid all these unfertilized egg, and that developed into an adult. So this was the first observation which was made by Brucier in 1847. And then similar observation was also made in 1866 by Tikhonov, wherein he reported that the eggs could be artificially activated by rubbing gently or by immersing in sulfuric acid for a short period. Then he also observed reproduction happening, and then a parthenogenetic way of reproduction happening. And then after 30 years in 1896, Richard Hertwig, he also described the initiation of cleavage in sea urchin eggs when they were immersed briefly in a dilute solution of strychnine, a chemical called as strychnine. And then by now many have observed such kind of such mode of reproduction happening, and then this concept of artificial parthenogenesis became quite common. Now you require some kind of stimulus to bring in about this artificial parthenogenesis. And that stimulus could be in the form of a physical agent, or it could be in the form of a chemical agent. Now, what are the physical agents that can induce parthenogenesis? One is the temperature. The temperature can stimulate the process of parthenogenesis, or it can induce the development of eggs and its reproduction. And then electric shocks can be used, and then ultraviolet rays have also been reported to cause or to induce parthenogenesis. And when the eggs are pricked by a fine glass needle, the development of young ones takes place, artificially, and hence you can bring about parthenogenesis. So these are some of the examples of physical agents which can bring in the process of artificial parthenogenesis. Then what are the chemical means? The following chemicals are reported to cause this parthenogenesis. They can induce or they can bring about this process of parthenogenesis. One is chloroform. I think you're all familiar with this compound. Then the second one is strychnine. Here there's a typographical error. It should be strychnine, not U. So just make a note of it. So it is a strychnine, which is a poisonous alkaloid, which is extracted from a plant which belong to the genus Strychnos, and hence the name strychnine. And this is used as a poison to kill rodents. And this chemical is also capable of inducing artificial parthenogenesis. In addition, you can make use of this hypertonic or hypotonic seawaters, the chlorides of potassium, calcium, sodium and magnesium, or acids such as butyric acid, lactic acid, oleic acid and other fatty acids. Then the fat solvents like the toluene, alcohol, benzene and acetone, urea and sucrose, all these can be used as chemical agents which can bring about or which can induce artificial parthenogenesis. And there are many examples across the phylum, starting from both invertebrates and vertebrates, in which this kind of process has been reported. Now finally, coming to the significance or advantages of this parthenogenesis. This is a process which serves as the means for determination of sex in case of honeybees and wasps. It supports the chromosomal theory of inheritance. Okay. And then it is the most simple, stable and easy process of reproduction, wherein the amount of energy that is required in this process is very minimal, and they can conserve more of energy by reproducing parthenogenetic way, and the energy that is spent on mating and all can be used on the other vital life processes. And this eliminates the variation from population. Now when I give you this statement, where parthenogenesis eliminates the variation from population, you can ask me, how is it advantageous or how is it significant? See, here there is two ways of looking at this particular statement. Parthenogenesis eliminates variation, thereby whatever the minimum characters are there in that particular gene pool will sustain, so you do not get variation. Variation doesn't mean always it is beneficial or always it is harmful. It could be both. So here both are not there. You know, a kind of consistency will be maintained. But at the same time, when there is no variation in a population, it will brings about a kind of check on the process of evolution. That is also there. So this can be looked in both the ways, in both advantages as well as disadvantage. When you look at the positive of it, it will not bring in any kind of variation, so that no harmful combination of genes are formed or flowed in the society, in the population. Okay. And then this parthenogenesis is the best way of high rate of multiplication. Example, in case of insects, and they can cause polyploidy, and this encourages development of advantageous mutant characters. And also parthenogenesis checks the non-adaptive combination of genes which may be caused due to mutation. And due to this parthenogenesis, there is no need for the organism to waste their energy in the process of mating, but rather it can be utilized in other vital process, as we said earlier. And this also avoids the sterility in races. Okay. So these are some of the points that you can mention under significance of parthenogenesis. Now here is a recap of what we have learned so far. So this slide tells you, like, it summarizes the whole lecture that we have learned. Now first we learned about parthenogenesis. We learned that it is of two types, natural and artificial. Under natural, you have two, complete and incomplete. Incomplete parthenogenesis is also known as cyclic or partial parthenogenesis. And then these two can be divided into haploid arenotocus or diploid telitocus parthenogenesis. And haploid or arenotocus parthenogenesis occurs in insects, arachnids and rotifers. Whereas diploid or telitoki can be again grouped into two, meiotic and ameiotic. And this case of meiotic parthenogenesis, you come across diplosis or doubling of chromosome. And this process of doubling of chromosome can be achieved by two ways. One is autofertilization and the other one is restitution. Now on the other hand, when you look into artificial parthenogenesis, that can be brought about by two different agents. One is either physical method or chemical method. Physical agents that are commonly used are temperature, electric shock, UV radiation, or pricking by a fine needle. Whereas the chemical method, the chemical agents that are used are chloroform, strychnine, hyper and hypertonic saline, then the chlorides of certain nonmetals, organic acids, urea and sucrose. So I would suggest you to note down this, copy the same schematic representation. That will help you to revise better, and you can also follow the content easily. So copy this in your notebooks. Then to conclude, we said that these parthenogenetic forms, they do not bring out, they are produced due to parthenogenesis, are not much successful in the struggle of existence, because we said it will not bring any kind of variation. There is no recombination of genetic material happening, and there is no variations that are produced. When we say there is no variation, then there is no possible of, you know, better characters being formed in the population. As a result, they become very susceptible to any kind of change in the environment. And when we say there are no variations, it also brings in a kind of hindrance to the process of evolution. So this process of parthenogenesis can be looked at as both advantageous and disadvantage also. So these are the reference books, and pictures are taken from these websites. Here are some questions for you to answer. The egg development without fertilization, it's very easy. It is known as parthenogenesis. Then complete parthenogenesis is characterized by, you should look at each and every option. If the first three options are correct, then you should go for D, which says all the above. Then the third one, alternation of sexual and parthenogenetic generation is seen in incomplete parthenogenesis. That is also called as cyclic or partial. So all are correct. Hence the correct answer is answer D. Then the fourth one, the possibility of exchange of genetic material and recombination of genes is not seen in complete parthenogenesis. And then artificial parthenogenesis can be induced by physical agents, chemical agents, both or none. You have to be very careful when you answer such kind of questions, because if you look at the options, physical agents is also correct, chemical agents is also correct, it cannot be none. And I have given one more option, like both. So you have to choose both. If you choose A or B, your answer will be wrong. So you have to choose option C. So I hope you enjoyed learning this concept of parthenogenesis. And if you have any queries or If you require any further explanation, you can write your queries to my email ID pilatadamodaran@gmail.com, and I've tried to put these concepts as simply as possible. And if you are curious to know more about the topic, you can Google and read about more examples in the same title. So thank you very much for listening to this lecture. I hope you all enjoy learning this process. Thank you.